The hotel manager had reserved the conference room for the two of them, and Le Chasseur found himself facing another TV screen, this time with a camera next to it. The screen was filled with the face of Akira Noguchi, peering owlishly at them through his thick eyeglasses.
Le Chasseur-san, ohayo gozaimasu. How is your stay?
Well, it's eventful. Thank you for agreeing to our request at such short notice, Noguchi-san. We need your advice. What do you know about foxes?
Foxes?
Yes, the shrines of the fox goddess Inari-sama.
There was a pause. The old man's face changed visibly as he muttered something in Japanese.
What was that?
Tatari. They are cursed.
Le Chasseur waited for the priest to continue. He did not.
Noguchi-san, I haven't got time to explain, but I think what's happening in Tokyo is something to do with those shrines. Could you be a little more specific?
The priest took a deep breath.
We Japanese take the Kitsune, the fox spirits, very seriously. There are shrines to Inari-sama all over Japan. There are so many stories from ancient times when humans lived side by side with the spirits of nature.
What do these stories say?
The Kitsune are trickster spirits, sometimes a force for good, sometimes for evil, or what humans would consider evil. In the old folk stories, they would mostly help people, but sometimes they would trick people or avenge themselves if they had been wrongly treated.
Would they trick or deceive people for sport?
No, not exactly. They are bound by a strict set of codes and honor, just like our society is. They appear to confuse people and be contradictory, but amongst themselves, they are consistent in their behavior.
What powers do they have?
They can appear in any shape they wish. They can wear the form of a beautiful woman or the most frightening ghoul. They can entrance the human mind and fill it with the most fantastic dreams and illusions. There is another story, recorded in the Kojiki, the Japanese creation myths, that tells of the Kurakabi, the Black Wall. It is a gateway to the spirit world, through which the Kitsune travel.
Le Chasseur clicked his tongue, lost in thought.
Let's say for the purpose of argument, he continued, that these foxes, these Kitsune, appear in modern Tokyo, that they came back. Do you think it likely that they would get up to their old tricks, hunt people, kill them?
Le Chasseur-san, the Kitsune do not kill in cold blood, and they do not hunt humans for sport. One notable thing about the stories is their sense of justice. If the Kitsune are wronged, they will retaliate, but they are not needlessly cruel. Remember, Inari-sama is also the goddess of rice and harvests. They can be cruel, yes, but they can be charitable. Do you know there are no fox legends on the island of Shikoku?
Why is that?
Because there are no foxes on Shikoku.
Le Chasseur snorted with mirthless laughter.
Noguchi-san, I don't really have the time.
Come and nasai, Le Chasseur-san. Please, forgive an old fool. But the story of how the foxes left Shikoku is interesting. The story tells us that a fox spirit impersonated the wife of a nobleman to confuse the nobles and to provide entertainment for the Kitsune themselves. When the woman's husband discovered the deception, he ordered that every fox on the island should be slain. But the next day, the fox spirits arrived
as a group to apologize and ask for the animals to be spared. At length, the nobles and the Kitsune came to an agreement. You see, they negotiated. There was a time when harmony was reached between man and spirits. Although this seems impossible now. And so, according to their vow, the Kitsune sailed away from Shikoku to seek a new home.
Leshisur sat back trying to digest all the new information. Nagushi-san, this is helpful. Most helpful.
Have you thought more about the rabbit? My father's riddle? Nagushi suddenly asked. If it could speak, what would it say?
Leshisur frowned. It would probably say it would rather be a fox.
Emily dreamed. It was a long, confusing dream and quite different from her usual night terrors. She was being pursued through the woods. No matter how far she tried to run, she never seemed to make any headway. Her legs felt incredibly heavy, like she was swimming in molasses. The thing that was chasing her howled. She plunged onward through mist and leaf mould, stumbling past trunk-like stems of bamboo. Red stains splashed upon the green. Above her, a storm of crows croaked as they took flight in panic, leaving the wood, forsaking Emily and whatever was hunting her. The mulchy forest floor, giving way beneath her, Emily pitched forward and jerked awake with a cry. It was broad daylight, motes of dust sparkling in the damp, close air of the hut. Emily was lying on bare earth in clothes that were gritty with sweat, the sack-like blanket twisted around her. The noise that had awoken her repeated itself, a man's voice shouting from outside. Judayu, at the window, let the curtain fall back into place as he looked down at Emily.
You will stay here.
Then he was through the door, marching outside. Emily scrambled to the window, lifting her head up cautiously to see outside. There were six horses and their riders outside, and Judayu was striding out to face them. They were not at all like the two men who had accosted her on the road the day before. They wore breastplates of overlapping scales of metal, held together with knotted metal cords. Their arms and legs were fitted with supple-looking greaves and gauntlets, short boots with studded soles resting in the stirrups. On their heads, they wore steel helmets with visors, wings protecting the sides of the face, and the crest of an insect resembling a dragonfly painted on the front. But the oddest thing was that they all had thick scarves of green material wrapped around their eyes. Emily peered hard to make sure that she wasn't mistaken. She wasn't. Each of the riders, except for two who stayed far back, almost at the place where the village huts began, had a thick blindfold with the same dragonfly crest covering his eyes. The rider in front, who was obviously a captain of the guard or someone of similar rank, called imperiously to Judeo.
So you are the one famous Judeo Kokichi. You know the men still laugh about you and your misfortunes over a few cups of rice wine, but I never expected to meet you in person. It is very stupid of you to upset the daimyo a second time, you know.
I am indeed a stupid old man. Perhaps if I cut off your head and put it on my shoulders next to mine, I would be smarter. Now state your business plainly, and then be gone.
Our business plainly is that we have been informed that you are harbouring a foreigner. Your village is well known for being tardy in offering taxes to the daimyo. Now it seems you are sheltering an outsider. This will not be received very well, I assure you.
In the shadowed interior of the hut, Emily sucked in her breath. The villagers, she thought.
The girl is a traveller who was lost in the forest, Judayu barked. How dare you commit such acts of rudeness in the name of the daimyo?
Rudeness? Don't speak to me of etiquette, old man. I have broken no etiquette here because you are beneath significance.
He grinned humorously at the Ronin, and then sat up proudly in his saddle.
Now, surrender the girl to us, or I'll cut you in half and burn down your hovel to get at her.
There'll be no need for that, Emily called. All heads turned to where the voice had come from. Emily had left the hut and walked out into plain view. Judeo stared at her furiously. I'll come with you, she said to the messenger.
Mistress Emily, Judeo muttered softly.
This is not your fault, Emily told him as sternly as she could, trying to conceal the trembling in her limbs. This is a decision that I am making. Do not try to follow me, Judeo. The Ronin bowed his head once.
That is a promise I cannot make, Mistress Emily.
The captain turned his head away and beckoned to the blindfolded men behind him. Four of them dismounted and stood there for a second, cocking their heads in a curious way, like dogs. Then they started to walk slowly but steadily towards Emily. All of them were connected by a length of rope held in their hands, and they fanned out as they walked towards Emily, as if they were spiders, and Emily the cowering fly before them. Of course, she thought as they got closer, these fox things can hypnotize people. Maybe if you can't see them, it doesn't work. That's why these men are working blind. Emily stayed where she was as the soldiers finally reached her. Working by touch, they began to wind the rope around her, pinioning her arms to her sides. After they had securely bound her, two of them slipped their hands into her pockets. Emily shuddered, but their faces betrayed no emotion, no gloating excitement, as they extracted the few possessions that she had brought with her. The mobile phone and the wristwatch were the source of brief but intense conversation between the group captain and Emily's guards. The phone was handed to the captain, who flipped it open and shut several times. He started visibly as the phone gave out its little musical chime when the cover was opened. Eventually, Emily was put up on a horse behind one of the riders, who mercifully wasn't blindfolded. As the horse trotted away, she craned her neck to see Judeo behind her, motionless at the door of his hut. There was no flicker of emotion upon his face as he watched the party leave. Leshasur paced the hotel room restlessly while he waited for Moshizuka to return from the car with what he'd asked him to fetch. Something is in the streets, he thought. Something has broken out. It slipped its leash and is now loose. The fetid air that spewed out from the city's air-conditioned buildings was like ragged breath from its throat. The darkness that oozed from among the trees in the city parks was shot through with the cold, hard glinting of its eyes. Mochizuka stepped through the door, slipping off his shoes and holding out what he'd brought. The gifts from the fashion show, the two jackets and the dress with which they had been presented by Ikari's model. Leshasur gingerly took the three items. He sat down on the bed, produced a cheap artist's cutting knife that he'd bought in the hotel convenience store, and eased the blade into the first jacket's inner lining.
Dudley Kotto! Hey, what are you doing? This is Haydn Chic original!
I'm making a few alterations.
Teasing the lining away from the stitching, while Mashizuka winced at the ripping sounds, Leshasur held the jacket up to the light.
Well, will you look at that?
They looked. Inside the jacket was a thin layer of dark, furry pelt, its dun colour speckled with patches of red and white. It seemed to change colour as they looked at it, shimmering like the tonic mohair of the jacket's exterior. And as Leshasur looked closely, he could see that the suggestion of movement was not an illusion. It was pulsating slightly in the room's dry air.
This is the same as we found under floor of haunted house?
Yes, I'm pretty sure it's the same stuff we saw last night.
So why it's in jacket?
I don't know.
Leshasur carefully slit open the linings of the other two gifts, quickly confirming that they also contained the same furry pulsating material. He gently folded up the garments and laid them on the bed beside him. Suddenly very tired, he bent forward and put his head in his hands.
They must be putting that stuff in all their clothes, he thought. People are fighting to get their hands on these brands, and this is what's in them. Poison. Ikari has contaminated this city. This place was schizoid to begin with, but now it's being tipped over the edge.
Leshasur sighed, lifted up his head. He felt in his pocket for the lucky rabbit's foot charm, pulled it out, held it between his hands and stared at it.
Hey, buddy!
Moshizuka's voice had assumed a clumsy American twang. What's matter?
Just thinking about the guy who used to own this.
Very good friend, eh?
Actually, I hardly knew him.
Leshasur blinked.
You know, if we can't really understand other people, I don't think we've got much of a chance of figuring out these things running around Tokyo.
He put down the charm, tried to rub the fatigue from his eyes.
And if the rabbit could speak, what would it say?
Ah, that what priests say to you, Narahodo? I used to have a rabbit when I was children. Very, very cute, hontani. To tell you the truth, I wanted to be a rabbit.
Is that so?
Huh. But now I realize it is too hard. Maybe I don't like being rabbit. Rabbit has to live outside and eat the grass. Me, I am rabbit. I don't want to eat the grass. I want to eat some hontani. Ashimono. Like really nice sushi.
Leshasur started to giggle. Then before he could contain himself, he burst out laughing. He looked sideways at Moshizuka and tried to remember the last time he had laughed.
You know, Moshizuka-san, you're okay.
Really? Arigato!
Leshasur stood up. Come on.
Ah, where are we going?
Back to Asakusa.
Moshizuka's enthusiasm disappeared like a switch had been thrown.
Mata? Uso daro?
Although he couldn't understand the language, Leshasur appreciated the sentiment.
Afraid so. Whatever this stuff is, there's got to be a reason why there's so much of it under the floor of a haunted house. Maybe Ikari or whoever will come back for it. So let's go and keep an eye on the place. And bring that jacket with you. Put it back in the car.
It took the best part of a day for Emily and her armed escort to travel on horseback to their destination. Although they stopped frequently to rest and to stretch their legs, Emily was starting to think that she wouldn't be able to walk on solid ground ever again. Their eventual destination was set among gentle hills at the end of a long avenue lined with cryptomeria. A set of massive wooden gates stood before them. The air was fragrant with the scent of the trees and nearby water. The captain called out to unseen ears, and the gates began to swing open. Grooms in strange uniforms with horizontal stripes that made Emily think of pictures of Victorian bathing costumes rushed out to guide the horses through the gates and to help the riders dismount. Gatekeepers armed with bows and halberds saluted them as they passed. She found herself in the open yard of a large complex of buildings, some of which she could identify as stables, storehouses, and plain wooden outbuildings that could conceivably be lodgings for servants. There were also courtyards, gardens, and in front of her, a huge building with a thick tiled roof shining silver and brown. This, then, was the stronghold of the daimyo. At each corner of the complex stood a watchtower, a shadowy figure moving around within it. Emily was carried to a chamber where she was laid on another earthen floor, this time pitted and stained by things she didn't want to speculate about. The blindfolded guards cut her bonds by touch alone and retreated backwards, closing the windowless door. She listened to the keys rattle in the lock as she rubbed her cramped limbs. Chin up, Emily, she thought. They brought you here for a purpose. If they wanted to kill you, they would have just run you through with one of their fancy swords. Across the room, something stirred. As her eyes adjusted to the gloom, she could see that the irregular bump in the floor was actually a blanket, with someone underneath it. "Hello?" she whispered nervously. "My name is Emily Blandish. It's all right. I'm not a spirit or a devil." Stupid, she thought. That's exactly what they'd expect a devil to say. The only reply was an incomprehensible moan. She shuffled over to the blanket. "Are you hurt?" she asked softly. "Can I help?" She thought of torture, of what a Japanese tyrant was capable of doing in such an age. Her hand reached out and gently pulled back the blanket. She froze where she was, mouth open, looking down at her fellow prisoner, her shock mixed with an undeniable sense of wonder. The head underneath the blanket lolled with its mouth open. No, not mouth. Jaws. Full of curved, pointed teeth, a long red tongue out and slavering as the creature panted in misery. Emily could feel the reality of its hot breath upon her hand. Black eyes blinked at her from matted reddish-brown fur, and a pointed snout protruded below a narrow, sloping forehead. A fox. A fox spirit. Despite her feelings of fear and disgust, Emily could see that the creature was hurt. The sleeve of the thing's kimono was clotted with dried reddish stains. At least the blood's the same colour, she thought. As she gingerly touched its hand, the creature flinched, but did not pull away. Well, I can't just sit here while someone is in pain, she thought, and that goes for animals and spirits as well as people. She pulled the blanket away completely, gingerly checking the body beneath the kimono. She had no idea what was normal for a fox that dressed like a human woman, but the pulse seemed rapid and weak, and moving the right wrist caused the thing to give out a heartbreaking whimper, as if there was a fracture beneath the skin. Tearing the thin blanket in half, she wrapped it around the creature's forearm to secure it against the left shoulder, tying the makeshift sling in a reef knot.
"Thank you," someone said in her head.
Emily knew that she was never really hearing people speak her own language. When she had listened to Moshizuka and his colleagues back in Tokyo, something in her mind had boiled down the stew of words and left her with the essence, the meaning of what they were trying to say. A similar process seemed to work the other way around. She would think what she wanted to say, and the appropriate language would somehow be heard by the other party. But this was different. Emily felt it more as a warm breath inside her head, the back of her skull tingling as words and concepts purred through her consciousness. This was something beyond animal, and truly beyond human.
"I am Hamori," it said. "Why are you here? You are not Kitsune. Why do the bold ones trap one of their own?"
"That is because I'm not one of these people. I'm not like them." Emily shook her head, not just for emphasis, but also from the bizarre sensation of having the inside of it licked by something like a cat's tongue. "I think you better tell me as much as you can," Emily said. The creature lay still for long seconds, its head lolling back on the rough floor, and Emily thought for a moment that it might be asleep. But then it stirred, and the voice sounded once more in her head.
"You do not have the scent of a village dweller, it is true. You have the scent of sweat mixed with fire, oil, and fear. You have the smell of that place where dreams are put in the box and pressed to death."
"You mean the city? The city in this land's future? Have you seen it?"
"I have not seen it. But the clans have ridden through the Black Wall to make their new lair. But how do you travel? You have no Black Wall."
"I don't know what a Black Wall is," Emily sat back, sighing in frustration and fatigue. "And I don't know who or what you are." The fox lifted itself up on one arm, the kimono slipping back from its fur, turning its head to fix Emily with black, gleaming eyes.
"We are Kitsune. We have lived for ages in this land. We have shared it with the bold ones. Our time is not the same as your time. We have not always been here, but we have made this our home. We have shared it with the other races, according to our laws and yours, until now."
"What's happened to change things?" The Kitsune let its head loll back on the filthy ground, exhausted.
"War,"
it said simply. The guards came for Emily at sundown. They came feeling their way with the dragonfly symbol blindfolds pulled down over their eyes to spin webs of rope around her body once again. Emily had accepted it as inevitable. What did dismay her, however, was that they also bound the injured Mamori and forced her, not it, she thought, to stumble along beside her. They were obviously being taken to the same destination.